Welcome back, Lifesavers, to another nursing video. My name is Nurse Kelly Tyrell, and in today's video, we are going to be covering the most common medication routes and abbreviations that you will need to know as a nurse. Buccal, intrathecal, nil per os, so what does it all mean? Well, you are about to find out soon enough, but before we jump into the video, make sure you subscribe to my channel, like, comment, and share this video with a friend, and make sure you click on that bell icon to turn on notifications so you don't miss out on my upcoming content. Okay, so you're a new nurse on the floor when suddenly a doctor yells at you, I need 0.6 mg, NTG, SLQ, 5 minutes times 3 stat. Wow, that is a mouthful, literally and metaphorically. Get it? Because nitroglycerin is given sublingual in the mouth. I know, it's just some corny nurse humor for you. But anyway, back to the serious stuff. So it's important to be able to process these emergent orders on the spot and act quickly, because the only way you're going to be able to do that is if you are familiar with medication routes and abbreviations. So let's start with the most common route, which is oral. So many different types of medications can be given this route, including liquids, capsules, tablets, and chewable tablets. So given medication orally is the safest and easiest way to administer medication, because most medication is going to be slowly digested and absorbed through the small intestines and into the bloodstream, making effects of the medication a lot less intense for the patient. Medications are going to be way more concentrated and have much higher risks when they're given through alternative routes that we will cover in just a few minutes. So when you see a medication written in the abbreviation PO next to the dosage, this will mean that you are to give the medication by mouth or orally. So for example, a very common order that you might see is Tylenol 650 milligrams, PO, Q6 hours, PRN, pain. So when you're giving any medication, you will always have a frequency in your order which follows the route of administration. So using the Tylenol order as an example, our frequency is going to be Q6 hours or every 6 hours. Now, what does PRN stand for? Well, PRN is a Latin term for pro rata natum, which essentially means when it's necessary. You'll see this most often with pain medication orders. It's also important to remember that a PRN order is considered wrong when there is no PRN reason listed. Wink, wink to all of my NCLEX students out there. So if the Tylenol order was written Tylenol 650 milligrams, PO, Q6 hours, PRN, without the word pain at the end of the order, then this would be considered an incomplete order. Another common abbreviation you'll want to be aware of when administering oral medications is the term NPO. So this Latin translation for NPO means nil per os, which literally means nothing by mouth. So you'll see this order written commonly when your patient is preparing to go into surgery. So just remember that NPO will typically mean no oral medications also, unless the doctor's order specifically states to continue with PO medications. You will also commonly see the term NPO when you're dealing with a patient who has dysphagia or swallowing issues, usually related to having a stroke or having an advanced airway place like a tracheostomy or an endotracheal tube. So it's important to check the diet orders before you give any oral medications, just to make sure that you're not putting your patients at risk for aspiration or choking. So what do you do if you have a patient who has an NPO order but you need to administer a certain type of medication? Well, there's several other options to be able to deliver medications. So the next most common medication administration route is the injection route. So there are several different ways you can inject patients with medications, including sub-Q or subcutaneous, which is given under the skin into that subcutaneous fat tissue. You have IM or intramuscular injection, which is given directly into a muscle, usually the deltoid or dorsogluteal and ventrogluteal muscles in the adults, and the vastus lateralis muscle for young children. You also have IV or intravenous, which means in a vein. You have ID or intradermal, which means just below the skin between the epidermis and the hypodermis. And you also have intrathecal, which means around the spinal cord. So what are the common types of medications that are given through each of these routes? Well, I can tell you that just about any oral medication will be available in an injection form, but let's just cover some of the most common ones that you may see. So we'll start with subcutaneous injections. So the most common medications that you will likely see when giving a sub-Q injection could be anticoagulants such as heparin or Lovenox. Also insulin, which includes your rapid acting insulins like Humalog and Novolog, your short acting like Humulin and Novolin, your intermediate acting like MPH, and your long acting insulins like Lantus and Levemir. And you also have your pre-mixed combos of long and short acting like the 70-30s of Humulin, Novolin, and Novolog, etc. So next are the IM injections. So the IM route is preferred over the subcutaneous route when larger volumes of a medication is needed. So the most common medications that you'll see with IM injections could include vaccines in adults and children, also opioid pain medications like hydromorphone, antibiotics such as penicillins and streptomycin, and hormone therapy like testosterone. Okay, so next we have the IV route. So when you're working in a hospital setting, this route is probably going to be the most common route of administration along with the oral medication route. Because, like I mentioned earlier, medications given this route through the IV are going to work way faster because they are absorbed directly into that bloodstream. The whole goal of a patient being admitted into the hospital is to get them better quickly so that way they can be discharged back to their prior living environment. So that is why IV medications are so highly used in the hospitals. And there are a ton of common medications given the IV route, but the ones that I've seen used most often are opioid pain medications like Dilaudid, fentanyl, and morphine. Also IV fluids or IVF for short, such as normal saline solution, lactated ringer solution, and D5W, which is dextrose in 5% of water or saline. Also antibiotics such as vancomycin, rocephin, and gentamicin. You have electrolytes for fluid replacement, such as potassium, which burns really, really bad, by the way. So quick nursing tip, you wanna try to dilute this with normal saline if you can. And you can do this by using a method called piggybacking, which essentially means you have a large volume IV fluid running like normal saline. And then you connect a smaller bag of medication to one of the Y ports on the IV tubing. And if you run both solutions together, it will help to dilute the potassium and lessen that irritation on the vein. You will also see magnesium given frequently through the IV as a replacement as well. And another common injection that you'll see through IVs is blood and blood products and also parenteral therapies. Next is the drugs for low blood pressure, such as dopamine, epinephrine, norepinephrine, and dobutamine. And lastly, chemotherapy drugs are often given through the IV route. And it's also important to know that there are several different types of IV lines. You have a standard basic peripheral line where the IV is inserted into any visible peripheral vein on the arms or hands. You also have three different types of central venous catheters or CVCs, which are used for longer term medications or really irritating medications like chemotherapy that can damage peripheral veins really easy. So the three different types of CVCs are a peripherally inserted central catheter, or a PICC for short. This is a long line that sends medication from the area of insertion, which is typically in the elbow or upper arm, through the veins all the way to a vein near the heart. You also have tunneled catheters. So with a tunneled catheter, medication can be sent directly into the veins of the heart. So one end of the catheter is placed into a vein in the neck or chest, and the rest of the catheter is tunneled through the body, with the other end coming out through the skin. And lastly is the implanted port. So just like with a tunneled catheter, an implanted port inserts a catheter into a vein in the neck or chest. But unlike a tunneled catheter, an implanted port is located completely beneath the skin. So to use this device, you will have to access the port by puncturing a little hole in the skin and then connecting an external catheter so that way you can deliver that medication. Okay, so let's move on really quickly to our last two injection routes, which are the intradermal and enteral fecal routes. So these two routes are your least commonly used routes, but the most common intradermal injections that you will see is when you're administering a TB skin test, or the allergy testing is also given through an intradermal route. The intrathecal medications are typically used for the control of pain in cancer and non-cancer conditions, and more for like severe chronic pain and also managing severe spasticity in adults and children. So the most common medications that you'll see given this route are going to be morphine, ziconotide, and baclofen. So some other routes of administration that you may see will include sublingual or SL, which is how you will give nitroglycerin tablets when a patient is complaining of chest pain. You have buccal routes, or BUC, which is when you place a medication in between the gums and teeth so they can dissolve and be absorbed more rapidly into the tiny capillaries and vessels in the mouth. You also have rectal and vaginal routes, both of which you will typically use when you're giving a suppository, and you'll see PR for per rectum and PV for per vaginally. You also have ocular routes, which includes three different types of abbreviations. You have OD, and this means oculus dexter or right eye, OS, which means oculus sinister or left eye, and then you have OU, and this means oculus uterine or both eyes. So you also have an otic route that you can give medications, or AU, and this means auricular, and that is given typically for eardrops in the ear. You also have nasal routes, which is typically used with corticosteroid allergy sprays. Also inhalation and nebulizer routes, which are typically used for inhalers and nebulizer treatments like albuterol to help manage conditions like asthma and COPD. Next, there's the transdermal route. And with this route, you'll place the medication directly onto the epidermis of the skin. And medications that are commonly used with this type of route includes different ointments and pain patches, like fentanyl or lidoderm, and you will also see nitroglycerin paste given this route as well. So another route you will commonly see is through a tube, such as a percutaneous endoscopic gastrostomy or PEG tube, and a nasogastric tube or an NGT for short. So with these types of tubes, since they are directly placed into the stomach, either surgically as with a PEG tube or through the nose and then down into the stomach like an NG tube, you can give any kind of oral liquid form of medication, which is the preferred choice, or you can give any crushable tablets that you can easily mix with water. You may also see an intraosseous route, or IO for short, which means that a needle is placed directly into the patient's bone marrow. So typically you will only see this in an emergency situation like a code blue, because this route has the highest risk for infection since you're introducing a foreign object directly into the bone marrow where those cells are made to actually fight infection. And lastly, in emergency situations where you absolutely cannot establish any other form of route of administration, you can give very few medications through an endotracheal tube route, or ETT. So the medications that you can give through this route include lidocaine, atropine, naloxone, epinephrine, and diazepam. And just a little trick, you can use the acronym LANED, L-A-N-E-D, to help you remember these medications. But it's important to remember, no matter which route you are using to provide medications, it is so, so important that you use your five rights of administration. Using the five rights of administration has proven to reduce medication errors and harm to patients. The five rights of medication administration are the right patient, the right drug, the right dose, the right route, and the right time. And that concludes the end of this lesson. I hope that you found this information extremely valuable and it made you just a little more confident as you prepare to take your NCLEX or your next nursing school exam. I just want to thank you all again so much, Lifesavers, for tuning in today. My name is Nurse Kelly Tyrell, and I help nurses feel more confident, increase their test scores, and retain what they don't remember in nursing school. Speaking of, are you a nursing student or soon to be, or ready to take your NCLEX? If so, have you joined joined my online student community yet? If not, then what are you waiting for? The University community is a complete nursing resource hub all at your fingertips. Inside, you can expect to receive coaching, community, and content. You'll get daily coaching with your mobile mentor, me, Nurse Kelly Tyrell. You'll also receive access to weekly educational videos that you can watch months before they even publish to YouTube. You'll also get exclusive printable digital downloads like worksheets, quizzes, flashcards, infographics, cheat sheets, skills checklists, and more. And if this video helped you in any way, be sure to give it a thumbs up. Also, don't forget to smash that subscribe button and click that notification bell so you don't miss out on my upcoming content. Also, if you can do me a favor and drop me a comment below, let me know where you're at with your nursing journey. I'd love to just say hi and connect with you. Also, make sure you click that share icon to spread the word and encourage a fellow aspiring nurse. And last but not least, when you are ready to take your NCLEX, be sure to check out my NCLEX and Chill review, where I review detailed test-taking strategies and cover every major topic that you can expect to find on the NCLEX. If you want to have that unfair advantage and pass your NCLEX on your very next attempt, be sure to click the link in the description box below. Not ready to end the study sesh yet? Well, you are in luck, because if you stick around, you can watch more of my videos coming at you in 3, 2, 1. Bye, lifesavers.